Hello. Welcome to our service of worship for Sunday, March 7th, the third Sunday in Lent. This is a communion service. For many of our residents, we will make communion available, but if you are communing in your own home, I encourage you to pause now and prepare your elements for your use later in the service. Those of you who have bulletins, I invite you to turn to the first page and join in Psalm 19, the psalm for the day, as a call to worship. The heavens tell the glory of God, the firmament proclaims God's handiwork. Day to day pours forth speech, and night to night declares knowledge. Their voice goes to all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. The sun comes out like a bridegroom from his wedding canopy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them. The Lord's law and decrees are perfect. They revive the soul. The Lord's precepts are right. They make the heart rejoice. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. There is great reward in keeping God's ordinances. Let the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Our first hymn today is the old classic, The Old Rugged Cross, which is connected with our gospel lesson for today. If you have a bulletin, I invite you to turn to the top of page 2 and join together in a prayer of confession. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we focus too much on capitalism and commercialism rather than on faith. Forgive us, we pray. Help us to drive the money changers out of our lives, that there might be room for you. Amen. Even when our focus is on things other than God, God's focus is always on us. We are the focus of God's love. And in that love, we are forgiven. Amen. So throughout this season of Lent, we have been hearing words from Hebrew scriptures to remind us of God's various covenants. Today we hear the familiar words from the book of Exodus that are perhaps one of the best known covenants. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in the heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of the parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. And at the top of page 3, we hear these words from Paul's first letter to the church at Corinth. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. And then from the Gospel of John. Now in John's Gospel, this incident occurs relatively early in Jesus' ministry. In the other Gospels, it occurs near the end and is often seen as part of the tipping point for why the religious leaders wanted him gone. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. Here ends this lesson. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. I do think it is too bad that we have come to call the passage from Exodus the Ten Commandments, because as a result, we tend to just view them as rules that were dictated to us, and that if we disobey, there will be massive punishments. But we must remember that this is just another covenant in a line of covenants that God has made with people throughout time, at least our human recorded history. First, we had the covenant promise to Noah with the rainbow in the sky. And then we had the promise to Abraham and Sarah that their descendants would be many and great. And now we have the covenant that reminds us how we can live with one another and with God. And of course, you and I, as Christians, understand that our greatest covenant promise and fulfillment comes in the person of Jesus the Christ. It is why we still worship in his name. It is why we are called Christians, because we believe that Christ brings that great covenant to fulfillment, to fruition. And so today we share at this table. It is our chance to celebrate those covenant promises that God has made so often. Normally, our communion table has a tablecloth over it. But for Lent, we tend to be a little more stark, a little more barren. But that means, and I know you can't really see it on your screen, but the front of the table is carved, "Do this in remembrance of me." So Jesus gives us this table, but we share in the covenant fulfillment when we share in the body and blood of Christ our Lord. We share in the covenant when we as a community share in communion. And although right now we are participating as a community physically separated, I hope that in this moment of sharing at the table, even if we're in our own rooms, our own homes, we sense that presence of the community and the presence of Christ and the Holy Spirit. We share in communion as an act of faith. We share in communion as a way to be reminded of the covenant God has made with us. One of my great joys when I entered seminary 30 years ago this year was to learn that there had been a movement in the Protestant church toward allowing and encouraging and inviting children to participate in communion. I grew up in a tradition where one did not share in communion until you had been confirmed, which usually happened somewhere around 7th, 8th, 9th grade. My Catholic cousins all got First Communion when they were somewhere between 5 and 8. And I do understand that there is value in having some formal education. But I firmly believe that the way we come to understand communion is by sharing in communion, not by watching the grown-ups around us do it without us, but in doing it together. And so many churches now do include children in communion. They may not understand intellectually, and frankly, if you have the perfect explanation, please share, because theologians have debated that for almost 2,000 years. There are multitudes of books written on the meaning of, the value of, the interpretation of communion. But children understand. I still remember one Sunday, as Sunday school was getting ready to convene, the deacons were gathering to prepare communion, and one of the children with great joy said, "Is this the day we get to share in Jesus?" That is what we are doing, my friends. We are sharing in Jesus. No matter where we may be physically located, we are sharing with him and with each other in this community of faith. And so as we share in this bread and this cup today, I hope that it will be a physical reminder for each of us of all of God's promises that we proclaim as fulfilled through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Merciful God, for nearly a year now, we have prayed for your world, your children, who have been affected by COVID, and we continue to do so today. We pray for those who have died and those who mourn them, those who are ill or recovering, those who have cared for them. We pray for those for whom the presence of this insidious disease has meant loss of job, income, safety, security, home. We pray for those who struggle each day, struggle with hunger, with homelessness, with loneliness. We pray for our world and we pray for our community. We continue to hold in our prayers the people of our country who were so adversely affected by strong weather conditions, particularly in the South. And while we in Wisconsin are seeing the promises of spring in melting snow and chirping robins, help us to remember that in this season of Lent, there is always Easter, there is always resurrection, there is always hope. Today we gather at this table as a way to celebrate together spiritually, even if we are not together physically. We ask your blessing upon each of us for whatever our needs may be this day. We pray for those who are distant from us but are held in our hearts. We offer all our prayers, O God, confident that you hear and that you respond with love. We have this faith because we have the covenant fulfillment of Christ, who taught us we could pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. On page 4, you will find our communion hymn, Hear, O My Lord. Beloved in Christ, the gospel tells us that on the first day of the week, Jesus Christ was raised from death and appeared to Mary Magdalene. On that day, Jesus sat with two disciples and was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the joyful feast of the people of God. Men and women of all nations gather about Christ's table. This table is for all who wish to know the presence of Christ and to share in the community of God's people. I invite you to turn to the top of page 5. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to God Most High. It is right to give God thanks and praise. We give you thanks, God of majesty and mercy, for calling forth the creation and raising us from dust by the breath of your being. We bless you for the beauty and bounty of the earth and for the vision of the day when sharing by all will mean scarcity for none. We remember the covenant you made with your people Israel, and we give you thanks for all our ancestors in faith. We rejoice that you call us to reconciliation with you and all people everywhere, and that you remain faithful to your covenant even when we are faithless. We rejoice that you call the entire human family to this table of sacrifice and victory. We come in remembrance and celebration of the gift of Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be the good news. Born of Mary, our sister in faith, Christ lived among us to reveal the mystery of your word, to suffer and die on the cross for us, to be raised from death on the third day, and then to live in glory. We bless you, gracious God, for the presence of your Holy Spirit in the church you have gathered, with your sons and daughters of faith in all places and times. We praise you with joy. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We remember that on the night of betrayal and desertion and on the eve of death, Jesus gathered the disciples for the feast of Passover. Jesus took bread and after giving thanks to you, broke the bread and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and after giving you thanks, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Eternal God, we unite in this covenant of faith, recalling Christ's suffering and death, rejoicing in Christ's resurrection, and awaiting Christ's return in victory. We spread your table with these gifts of the earth and of our labor. We present to you our very lives, committed to your service in behalf of all people. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit on this bread and cup, on our gifts, and on us. Strengthen your universal church, that it may be the champion of peace and justice in all the world. Restore the earth with your grace that is able to make all things new. Be present with us as we share this meal and throughout all our lives, that we may know you as the Holy One, who with Christ and the Holy Spirit lives forever. Amen. The bread which we break is Christ's body broken for us. The cup of blessing which we bless is the new covenant poured out for us for forgiveness of sins. This is the joyful feast for the people of God. Come, for all things are now ready. I invite you to take what you have prepared in your home and join in communion. The body of Christ broken for you, take and eat. The cup of blessing poured out for you for forgiveness of sins. Take and drink. I invite you to join in the prayer on the bottom of page 6. Let us pray. Bountiful God, we give you thanks that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And our final hymn is the well-known and well-loved "How Great Thou Art." Go from this time of worship, having been fed at the sacred table, and having heard the good news. Love and serve the Lord. Amen. Thank you for joining us today.